Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Devil's Due by Taylor Anderson, narrated by William Dufris.
Our History Here. By March 1, 1942, the war back home was a nightmare. Hitler was strangling Europe, and the Japanese were rampant in the Pacific. Most immediate, from my perspective as a mature Australian engineer stranded in Surabaya, Java, the Japanese had seized Singapore and Malaysia, destroyed the American Pacific Fleet and neutralized their forces in the Philippines, conquered most of the Dutch East Indies, and were landing on Java. The one-sided battle of the Java Sea had shredded Abda Float, a jumble of antiquated American, British, Dutch, and Australian warships united by the vicissitudes of war. Its destruction left the few surviving ships scrambling to slip past the tightening Japanese gauntlet. For most, it was too late. With several other refugees, I managed to board an old American destroyer, USS Walker, commanded by Lieutenant Commander Matthew Reddy. Whether fate, providence, or mere luck intervened, Walker and her sister Mahan, their gallant destroyermen cruelly depleted by combat, were not fated for the same destruction that claimed their consorts in escape. Instead, at the height of a desperate action against the mighty Japanese battlecruiser Amagi, commanded by the relentless Hisashi Kurokawa, they were engulfed by an anomalous force, manifested as a bizarre greenish squall, and their battered, leaking, war-torn hulks were somehow swept to another world entirely. I say another world, because, though geographically similar, there are few additional resemblances. It's as if whatever cataclysmic event doomed the prehistoric life on our Earth many millions of years ago never occurred, and those terrifying, fascinating creatures endured, sometimes evolving down wildly different paths. We quickly discovered people, however, calling themselves Mianaka, who are highly intelligent, social folk, with large eyes, fur, and expressive tails. In my ignorance and excitement, I promptly dubbed them Lemurians, based on their strong, if more feline, resemblance to the giant lemurs of Madagascar. Growing evidence may confirm they sprang from a parallel line, with only the most distant ancestor connecting them to lemurs, but Lemurians has stuck. We just as swiftly learned they were engaged in an existential struggle with a somewhat reptilian species commonly called Grik. Also bipedal, Grik display bristly crests and tail plumage, dreadful teeth and claws, and are clearly descended from the dromaeosaurids in our fossil record. Aiding the first group against the second, Captain Reddy had no choice. We made fast, true friends who needed our technical expertise as badly as we needed their support. Conversely, we now also had an implacable enemy bent on devouring all competing life. Many bloody battles ensued while we struggled to help our friends against their far more numerous foes, and it was for this reason I sometimes think, when disposed to contemplate destiny, that we survived all our previous ordeals and somehow came to this place. I don't know everything about anything, but I do know a little about a lot. The same was true of Captain Reddy and his U.S. Asiatic Fleet sailors. We immediately commenced trying to even the odds, but militarizing the generally peaceful Lemurians was no simple task. Still, to paraphrase, the prospect of being eaten does focus one's efforts amazingly, and dire necessity is the mother of industry. To this day, I remain amazed by what we accomplished so quickly with so little, especially considering how rapidly and tragically our brain trust was consumed by battle. In the meantime, we discovered other humans, friends and enemies, who joined our cause, required our aid, or posed new threats. Even worse than the Grik, from a moral perspective in my opinion, was the vile dominion in South and Central America. a perverse mix of Incan, Aztec, and blood ritual tyranny, with a dash of 17th century Catholicism, flavoring technology brought by earlier travelers. The Dominion's aims were similar to the Grik's. Conquest, of course, but founded on the principle of convert or die. I now believe that, faced with only one of these enemies, we could have prevailed rather quickly, despite the odds. Burdened by both, we could never concentrate our forces, and the war lingered on. To make matters worse, the Grik were aided by the madman Kurokawa, who, after losing his Amagi at the Battle of Balgpan, pursued a warped agenda all his own. And just as we came to the monumental conclusion that not all historical human timelines we encountered exactly mirrored ours, we began to feel the malevolent presence of yet another power centered in the Mediterranean. This League of Tripoli was composed of fascist French, Italian, Spanish, and German factions from a different 1939 than we remembered, and hadn't merely crossed over with a pair of battle-damaged destroyers, but possessed a powerful task force originally intended to wrest Egypt and the Suez Canal from Great Britain. We had few open conflicts with the League at first, though they seemed inexplicably intent on subversion. Eventually, we discovered their ultimate aim was to aid Kurokawa, the Grik, even the Dominion, just enough to ensure our mutual annihilation, removing at one time multiple future threats to the hegemony they craved. But their schemes never reckoned on the valor of our allies or the resolve of Captain Matthew Reddy. Therefore, when the League Contre-Admiral Laborde, humiliated by a confrontation, not only sank what was essentially a hospital ship with his monstrous dreadnought Savoie, but took some of our people hostage, including Captain Reddy's pregnant wife, and turned them and Savoie over to Kurokawa.
Excerpt from the foreword to Courtney Bradford's The Worlds I've Wondered, University of New Glasgow Press, 1956. Prologue. Sovereign Nest of Jaff Hunters, Zanzibar, October 18, 1944. Sandra Tucker Reddy had been inwardly terrified when that fascist French weasel, Victor Gravois, handed her and her companions to the Japanese after the League of Tripoli battleship Savoie sank SMS America and brought them here. She'd seen what the Japanese on her old world were doing to prisoners of war when Mizuki Maru and Hidoyame arrived, so she'd known how bad it might be. Instead, for now, it certainly could have been worse. She and her young companion, Diania, had been separated from Chairman Adar, Capitan Leutnant Becker Lang, Gunnery Sergeant Arnold Horn, and the three Lemurian sailors she'd never even come to know, and locked in a small wooden shed, taller than it was wide. It was obvious by the streaked droppings that the structure was built as a nesting coop for lizard birds to lay their eggs for human harvest. The vicious duck-sized flying reptiles were like the Akka on Borno, and could apparently tolerate one another long enough to jumble their eggs together in enclosed, shady places before abandoning them to hatch. The first to do so feasted on the others until large enough to fly and re-enter the food chain outside. Attrition was horrendous, of course, but lizard birds had no mating season, and there was a constant flow of careless mothers. Even now, they often darted through gaps high in the walls beneath the thatched roof and fluttered around inside. Finding the nesting shelves removed, they usually painted the place, and Sandra and Diania, with more foul-smelling excrement before flitting somewhere else to dump their eggs. At least the gap allowed daylight and a slight breeze to stir the stifling heat, lizard bird shit stench, and sour sweat reek pervading their prison. Sandra and Diania were both small women, and even standing on each other's shoulders, they couldn't reach high enough to peer outside, let alone escape. And if they did, where would they go? Sandra knew they were on an island, probably Zanzibar, completely controlled by the Japanese and their Grik allies. She couldn't imagine how they'd get away. Meals came twice a day, delivered by a young Japanese sailor flanked by two fearsome Grik carrying wickedly barbed spears. The young man never met their eyes, wouldn't speak, and acted almost ashamed. He also seemed resentful, even terrified of the reptilian Grik accompanying him. That surprised Sandra, since she thought the Grik here served the Japanese. But the sailor was just a kid, and Grik were very frightening. It was probably as simple as that. Their meals were always the same tasteless glop of unidentifiable vegetable matter mixed with gobbets of meat she didn't want to identify, but they weren't being starved. She and Diania even had enough energy for light exercise and practicing some disabling moves that Diania's lost love, Chief Gray, had taught her. And as bad as they smelled after weeks confined aboard Savoie, plus another week here with lizard bird crap in their hair, they kept their cell as clean as they could. The single refinement easing their captivity was a box seat for them to do their business, with the waste dropping to the sand below. Even that was periodically removed by Grik fatigue parties, so they didn't have to endure that rising stench as well. Diania had seen the Grik tasked with the chore through the hole in the seat, and the women had shared a rare giggle at the thought of bombing them. Fortunately, Sandra supposed, though she remembered plenty of reports of atrocities in 42, the Japanese who had them now arrived when they thought they were winning the war back home, before it degenerated to a level of savagery that could fill a Mizuki Maru with living skeletons under the care of men who, in their post-arrival panic, actually considered eating them. Most of those men, along with Hiro Yame and even Mizuki Maru, which had been given a chance at least to redeem herself, were dead. And some of the skeletons had survived and recovered. Gunny Horn was one, Sandra remembered. Wherever the others are, he has to be in a special hell right now. Unfortunately, however, regardless of the prevailing circumstances when Sandra and so many she cared about aboard the old Asiatic fleet destroyer USS Walker were hounded and somehow followed to this world by the massive battlecruiser Amagi and these very Japanese, the wars raging here had achieved their own unique barbarism. Walker and her people had sided with the then relatively peaceful Lemurians, cat monkeys, some called them, who had fought and eluded the dreadful Grik for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Voluntarily or not, Amagi's commander, Hisashi Kurokawa, united with the Grik. What was more, he apparently blamed everything that had happened to him, from being marooned on this strange world in the first place, and the loss of his Amagi, to all the ordeals he had endured since, on USS Walker. And the greatest measure of blame was laid more specifically at the feet of her captain, Sandra's husband, Lieutenant Commander Matthew Reddy. Sandra stirred from where she had been sitting, just staring at the wall, and looked at Diania. In contrast to Sandra's tanned but fair skin and sandy brown hair, the tiny expat impi gal's hair was almost black, her skin dark. Most of her people had spent the past 200 years intermarrying with subjects of the terrible Holy Dominion in Central and South America, with whom the United Homes and their allies were also at war. She and most women of the Empire of the New Britain Isles, where the Hawaiian Islands ought to be, had once been practically a slave. That system had ended, but her previous condition probably helped her cope with the situation better than Sandra had. Diania was staring back, concern and compassion in her dark brown eyes. Sandra forced a smile.
"We'll be okay," she managed a bit hollowly.
"I am,"
Diana dutifully replied.
"Though I do wish we knew what they'd done with Adar and the lads," she added. "They won't hurt them, yet,"
Sandra said, the qualification slipping out before she could stop it.
"They'll use them however they can,
even if it's just to make use of us. And they'll wonder if Adar's really as useless to them as he claims to be.
Diania looked down and Sandra berated herself. She hadn't been as encouraging as she had planned. She forced a smile.
Gunny Horn likes you, I think.
Diania looked up, searching.
You do.
Sandra was stunned by how intensely her friend reacted. She'd wanted Diania to begin clawing out of the shell of grief she'd built around herself when Fitzhugh Gray was killed at Grik City, but hadn't really expected it so soon. Certainly not under these circumstances.
Hope is a very strange thing, she told herself, and comes at the strangest times. Here we are, helpless and surrounded by enemies, and her fondest wish is that some guy she barely knows might have noticed her. Maybe that's how she copes so well. She just thinks of something, someone else.
I do,
Sandra assured, her tone lighter. Then she managed a genuine smile and put her hand on the battered medical bag full of clothing and a few medicines she had managed to keep in spite of everything. The Frenchman on Savoie had been too rattled by other events and her distracting performance to search it when they took her aboard. The Japanese likely assumed the French had already done it and passed it off as what it appeared to be, a bag full of nothing useful to them.
They'll regret that, Sandra swore to herself,
considering the amazing luck that had allowed her to conceal a certain deadly object for so long. General of the Sky, Muraname, despite badly disguised hungry stares, had been true to his word to protect them from hundreds of sex-starved Japanese. At least until Kurokawa returned. Sandra's smile faded.
But Kurokawa's back now.
The planes that flew in and landed and all the noise coming from the docks that morning had practically confirmed it.
So, Sandra thought, maybe we'll know something soon.
She looked intently at Diania.
Horn's a good man, she assured her. He didn't have to come, but he did. And I bet that was largely because of you.
Granted, she told herself grimly,
he'd probably be dead now if he hadn't come, along with maybe 3,000 wounded men and cats who went down with America. But if it helps Diania pass the time, why not encourage her to think about other things, hope for something else?
She patted the pack beside her.
It makes me feel better. Imagining what I can do with what's in there, and hoping I get a chance to use it.
The lock clattered and the door banged open. Outside, a Japanese officer stood in the light of the setting sun. He was holding a white handkerchief over his nose, and instead of Grik guards, he had a pair of armed Japanese sailors. If they had Grik with them this time, they'd stayed out of view. Brusquely, the officer motioned the women to their feet.
You come!
He shouted. Sandra glanced at the bag and picked it up as she stood, berating herself for not hiding its important content on her person sooner.
Perhaps I still can. All I can do is try.
Stay that here, the man stressed. Not change place. Come back.
Sandra nodded exaggeratedly, turning slightly away and staring in the bag as if wondering if she'd ever see it again, regardless of what the officer said. Finally, she took what she hoped looked like a wistful breath and tossed the bag on the wooden floor. No one saw her secret, a very small 380 Colt pistol in her waistband as she made a show of tucking her filthy shirt in her dungarees. For once, the gloom in their cell and the sharp, bright sunset worked to her advantage.
Let's go, Diania,
Sandra said, her tone dripping scorn at their captors.
We may as well do as they say. No sense frightening them by resisting.
Apparently the Japanese officer understood more English than he spoke because his eyes narrowed and he drew back a hand to strike Sandra across the face. With a supreme effort, he controlled his impulse and grabbed Sandra's wrist instead, wrenching her bodily out of the cell. Diania crouched to spring, but Sandra quickly shook her head.
No, Diania.
She had no doubt the tiny wildcat could disable one guard, maybe two,
who'd be caught completely by surprise. And Sandra was pretty confident she could take out the abusive officer quickly enough to assist her friend with a third man. But now wasn't the time. It was still daylight. Men and Grik were watching, and they had no plan at all. They'd be recaptured, if not killed, and any future attempt would be far more difficult. Best let their captors continue to underestimate them.
"Let's just find out what they want, sweetheart," Sandra said more softly.
Reluctantly, Diana stepped forward and allowed herself to be seized by one of the sailors. Sandra was interested to see that the man took Diana's wrist much more gently than the officer had taken hers. Their escort marched them briskly down a tree-covered path toward the harbor, the same they had used when first taken to their cell. The first thing Sandra noticed, besides Savoy's huge brooding shape secured to the pier, its big guns bristling in what seemed all directions, was that the force Kurokawa had apparently brought back was considerably smaller than Murinami told her he'd set out with. Several more of the former Grik ironclad battle wagons were still under conversion to aircraft carriers at the extensive shipyards Kurokawa had established here, but they had been there when Sandra and her friends arrived. None appeared much closer to completion. Their armored casemates and guns had already been removed when Sandra saw them last, leaving their hulls floating high in the water. The framing for their flight decks had begun, and they rode a little lower, so she assumed their engineering plants had been the focus of alteration. Either way, they clearly remained weeks, at least, from readiness, and only one of the three finished carriers Kurokawa took to strike T.F. Alden was moored in the bay. Several of the returned ironclad steam cruisers looked a little battered as well. She prayed that meant T.F. Alden, with all its planes, new weapons, ammunition, and reinforcements, had bowled through to Matt on Madagascar and decisively kicked Kurokawa's ass. She shook her head to clear her mind as they passed through a palisade surrounding a large building, carefully camouflaged from the sky, and stepped on a rough-hewn porch. She suspected she'd need all her wits to leave this building alive, and, just as important, steer the enemy's thoughts in the direction she wanted them to go. A door stood open, allowing the evening breeze to cool the interior, but the senior guard stopped and knocked respectfully.
"Bring them in,"
came an almost cheerful voice Sandra didn't recognize, touched only lightly with an accent. Murinami had warned her about Kurokawa's mood swings and volcanic temper. She'd watch for signs he was losing it, and would redirect it if she could. She couldn't help wondering what had him in such a good mood, however, and the possibilities made her wary. The guards pushed her and Diana into the room, and Sandra was surprised by the contrasting decor. The walls were rough wood, like the rest of the building, but a richly woven rug, probably a tapestry taken from some sea-going Lemurian home, covered the timber floor. Colorful curtains swayed with the breeze beside broad glassless windows on the seaward side of the room, and a great, carefully crafted wooden desk dominated the space in front of smaller windows in the wall to landward. General of the Sky Hideki Murinami stood to one side of the desk, peering through wire-framed glasses perched on his nose, his prematurely bald head glistening in the light of lamps spaced around the walls. He was frowning, his hungry leer no doubt tempered by how filthy they were. He actually raised a white handkerchief of his own near his nose before he caught himself. "They sure have a lot of those white hankies," Sandra thought, distracted by the notion. But her gaze went to a short, roundish man with an equally round face sitting behind the desk. His uniform was immaculate, and though reminiscent of those worn by naval officers of the Japanese Imperial Navy, was decorated with all sorts of fanciful medals, devices, and colorful ribbons. It was so ridiculously ostentatious, in fact, that she had to force herself not to snort with amusement.
"Surely even he can't take all that seriously," she thought. "But maybe he does," she reconsidered.
He probably did it to impress his Grik allies at first, but by all accounts, even Morinami's, Kurokawa is quite mad. Best not to antagonize him, at least over something like that, she amended. Kurokawa alone seemed immune to their reek and appearance, and his expression was almost benign as he stood from the chair behind his desk, regarding her and Diania with keen interest. His slightly bulging eyes focused on Sandra.
Ah, he said. I finally have the honor of meeting the great healer of the Alliance.
He spoke with a growing note of sarcasm, lips stretched in a thin line across his small teeth.
How unfortunate that you cannot heal the reverse your cause recently suffered north of Mahe Island.
Or, he actually began to smile,
the apparent loss of both your husband's puny destroyers.
Sandra felt her bones turn to fire.
He's lying,
she screamed inside, but managed to control herself, even affecting a confused expression.
I've no idea what you're talking about. My companions and I were confined by murderers representing the League of Tripoli, as you know full well.
She jerked her head toward the battleship, docked less than a quarter mile away.
And then by your people here.
She glared at Morinami.
If you fought a battle against my husband's fleet, this is the first I've heard of it.
She stood straighter.
And it looks like your fleet needs a little healing, she said, then added, so I'm not sure I'd be so confident you achieved all you think you did if I were you.
With that jab, she saw the flames of fury flicker behind Kurokawa's eyes, but he retained his composure.
In that case, I will happily describe the action, Kurokawa said,
turning to pace behind his desk.
It's not as if you can make use of the information after all.
He abruptly stopped and regarded her anxiously.
Would you like refreshment?
When Sandra didn't reply immediately, his lip curled in a satisfied sneer.
I apologize for not asking you to seat yourselves, but I must preserve the furniture. It's so difficult to obtain these days. In the future, you'll take better care to come before me more appropriately attired.
The impossibility of his demand seemed to amuse him, and he began to pace once more.
True, he continued. We lost two of our carriers and a few insignificant auxiliaries, while your husband lost not only Balkpan Bay, a heavy fleet carrier, if I'm not mistaken, but also some sort of immense seaplane tender built from one of the Grik dreadnoughts we abandoned at Madras. Those sinkings are confirmed, as are those of at least a dozen support ships, vessels whose loss will leave your forces on Madagascar feeling a distinct pinch, I assure you. Particularly with General Esch and his Grik hordes preparing to cross the channel from the mainland of Africa and crush your ridiculously overextended force. Esch's new swarm is so numerous, it makes all his previous armies pale to insignificance. Furthermore, as I said, I have reliable reports of grievous hits made upon both your husband's modern destroyers, Walker and Mahan. At least one couldn't have survived, given the extent of her damage. You'll pardon me if I choose to revel in the possibility that it was your husband's Walker.
Sandra's mind whirled. Mahan was still laid up at Madras, the last she heard, and Walker couldn't have been with T.F. Alden. Matt wouldn't have seen the need to meet it with his own damaged ship when the task force was protected by two brand-new destroyers, just delivered and virtually identical to Walker. So, despite all the intelligence the League of Tripoli leaked to Kurokawa, he and they hadn't known about the new DDs. She felt sick to think they might already be lost, in addition to Balkpan Bay and the rest, but at least she was morally certain Kurokawa was wrong about Walker and Matt.
I wouldn't count on that, she whispered.
I won't,
Kurokawa snapped, his tone deadly serious, no longer gloating.
Despite the fact I must destroy him, your husband has earned my grudging respect for all he has accomplished with so little.
He waved around him.
As have I. And I will never underestimate him again. But the balance of power, in this theater at least, has finally shifted in my favor. Yes, he added,
noting Diania's surprise.
I know all about your war with the Dominion in the Americas.
Sandra did snort then. We still have two carriers to your one. With more on the way, and whether our destroyers were sunk or not, our steam frigates are a match for your so-called cruisers. I didn't hear all that many planes fly ashore this morning either, so you obviously lost a lot of those, as well as pilots. How do you figure you're on top?
Simple, my dear Lady Sandra,
Kurokawa said, using the title the Imperials had given her. Probably as yet another means of showing how much he knew. In fact, Sandra got the distinct impression this entire meeting was little more than an opportunity to boast to her, the next best thing to having Captain Reddy himself.
Your forces on Madagascar will soon have all they can deal with once the Grik attack in earnest. My air force is depleted, but I'll soon make up my losses in quantity.
He smiled.
And quality. Lastly, I noted you didn't mention the converted freighter, the Santa Catalina. Your people armed and styled a protected cruiser. Do you honestly believe she can match Savoie, after my people have time to familiarize themselves with her? You're not that stupid.
He bestowed a gleeful smile on Muraname.
And how long will that take?
Sandra glanced at Muraname as well, gauging his reaction.
How many of Savoy's people stayed behind? Not many, I guess. And how many Amagi sailors do you have left, not flying planes, supervising factories and shipyards, or commanding ships? They must be spread awful thin. I don't know much, she confessed, but I imagine properly operating Savoy with her sophisticated equipment and modern weapons will be a lot harder than your crude ironclads with muzzle-loading guns.
She could tell her shot hit home with Muraname, at least, when he frowned and blinked rapidly behind his glasses. Kurokawa's eyes bulged slightly more and his face reddened, but he didn't respond.
So, Sandra continued, getting down to it, absently adjusting her shirt tail with one hand near the Colt,
while resting the other on the bulge in her belly that was finally beginning to show.
What will you do with us, Diania and I, and the two men and four Lemurians you're holding?
That depends a great deal upon you,
Kurokawa said simply.
I have uses for you all, of course, not all equally pleasant. For instance, it's been a great while since I, or the more than 300 real men it remains my honor to command, have enjoyed the company of a woman.
Sandra took a step back, horrified, but Kurokawa nodded at her belly.
You're pregnant, and though you carry the child of my greatest enemy, I'm not a monster.
He swiveled his head to regard Diania.
Your servant, on the other hand, is not pregnant. Is she?
He glared back at Sandra, and she saw the fury in his eyes again.
To preserve her and your friends from any number of unpleasant fates I might imagine, you'll tell me what I want to know.
You are a monster.
Sandra breathed softly, noting that Kurokawa actually looked strangely disturbed to hear her say it. For some reason, possibly because of his expression, she left the little Colt where it was and allowed her hand to fall to her side.
I have no illusions about that, she said more loudly.
But you already know as much as I could tell you, more, probably, with the League whispering in your ear. What else is there?
The League, Kurokawa spat, cares nothing for me except insofar as I might advance their own murky agenda. They give me information, and they gave me Savoie, true. There are even other ways in which they'll still aid me. But what I want to know is, if Captain Reddy still lives, what will he do when he discovers I have you?
He leaned forward expectantly. Sandra glanced at Diania, frowned, and finally shrugged. There was a time when he would have started a war to save me. He kind of did, in a way. That's how we wound up involved in the Imperial's war against the Dominion, all because I was incidentally abducted along with the heir to the throne of the Empire of the New Britain Isles, and Matt thought certain people were holding us. She looked Kurokawa directly in the eye. The thing is, he would have done the same even if they'd only taken the Governor Empress, because she was under our protection. She shrugged again. And I would have absolutely supported his decision. As it turned out, we'd already escaped, but that didn't stop him. Not even a brand new war, while we were already up to our necks fighting you and the Grik, made a difference to him because it was the right thing to do. If that Matt Reddy knew you had us, and Adar and me in particular, he'd come at you with everything he had. She shook her head. I doubt that's any secret to you. Now, she said quietly, he's changed. He's changed a lot. He loves me just as much, I don't doubt that, but he's grown harder than that.
Harder?
Kurokawa demanded.
Like me?
He's nothing like you, Sandra snarled contemptuously. The difference is, now he's hard enough not to drop everything and come right after us, after you. He's grown hard enough to lose us, to take the hit and keep on fighting, regardless of the cost to me or any of the others. Her blue eyes turned as remorseless as the sea. And if you hurt us, any of us, he will kill you. Make no mistake. But he'll do it in his time and won't waste lives. That's the most important thing to him now. This war's cost him, cost us all, so much that he just wants it over. But he also wants it won. So he'll leave me here until it is, if he has to. But then he'll come for me. She gave Diania a gentle glance. He'll come for all of us. But most important, he'll come for you, even if all he gets is revenge.
And if I tell him I have you, that I'll kill you if he does not come,
Kurokawa demanded, eyes searching hers.
There it was.
Unknowingly, he'd finally confirmed her suspicion that despite all the battles fought across half this wildly mysterious world over the past 2.5 years, no matter how many other enemies and friends joined the struggle, regardless how many murky threats loomed on the horizon, the whole vast impersonal war he'd helped fuel and feed with blood remained profoundly personal to Hisashi Kurokawa. There'd been little question in Sandra's mind that he had tried to use her and their unborn child against Matt to bring on what he apparently wanted most, a final confrontation between them. Unfortunately, despite what she had said, she could imagine nothing that would focus her husband's rage more destructively and, perhaps, disastrously at this critical time, and Kurokawa was likely to get his wish. His retribution will only be more terrible, Sandra said, staring back with all the defiance she could muster. But killing us won't bring it any quicker, she lied. You just don't get it, do you? She asked, her tone filled with wonder as she returned to the absolute truth. You fight only for yourself, to destroy. He's fighting to save a race of people, maybe the whole damn world. He's idealistic, don't you see? Tears welled up in her eyes, and she wiped them with her grimy sleeve and looked away. Next to that, my fate's nothing in the short term, she whispered, with as much conviction as she could summon. But in the long term, whatever you do to me, to us, it won't be as bad as what he does to you. For an instant, Sandra thought Kurokawa actually was going to lose it, order the guards to kill her then and there, and maybe march out and shoot all her friends with the pistol at his side. With tremendous effort, clear to see beneath his purpling face, however, he slowly brought himself under control. Finally, he nodded.
"I believe you," he ground out. "And that's fortunate for you,"
he nodded at Diania,
"and your servant as well. I must consider this for a time, all you have said. Until then, at least, you'll not be harmed or molested," he commanded,
raising his voice so his order would carry to the guards who had brought them.
"I gave my word,"
he added under his own breath,
"and I'm not a monster."
Suddenly, striding around the desk, he beckoned at someone in the adjoining room. There were words, then a rustling, scraping sound. To Sandra's astonishment, two more guards dragged a third form into the room by its arms and seated it on a chair. There, apparently unable to rise or do more than hold his head up, sat Chairman Adar.
"Oh my God!"
Sandra cried, rushing to him despite the efforts of her guard to hold her back. She knelt in front of the Lemurian leader, a new fury rising that threatened to explode when she saw her friend's face. Adar was about 40, the same as his lifelong friend, Admiral Kijifris Ar. That wasn't particularly old for Lemurians, who generally lived about as long as humans, but Adar looked very old now to Sandra's searching eyes. Always thin, he'd become practically emaciated, his gray fur matted, and silver eyes dull as he regarded Sandra without apparent recognition. He still wore what his American friends had dubbed his Sky Priest suit, with silver stars embroidered on the hood and shoulders, but it was just as torn and dingy as the Lemurian wearing it. Sandra wheeled to glare at Kurokawa.
"What have you done to him?" she roared.
Kurokawa actually blanched, but his face purpled again and his eyes bulged enormously.
"Only I demand here, Minister Reddy,"
he snapped, using her medical title within the United Homes and the Grand Alliance. He glanced at Muriname, however.
"But the General of the Sky assures me nothing has been done to him, beyond subduing him and the others' continuing misguided resistance. Other than that, he simply won't eat. Nor will the other ape men. Gunnery Sergeant Horn and Capitan Lieutenant Lang both say his people,"
he nodded at Adar,
"cannot thrive in captivity. Is this true?"
"Of course it's true,"
Sandra stated. And it was, to a degree. But she had never expected this. She immediately decided Adar was literally starving himself to death to keep the Japanese from using him against his people, and the cat sailors were doing the same to corroborate his excuse. In a way, it was brilliant, and she suddenly wished she could get away with something similar. "But that won't work with us," she knew, "or for Horn and Lang." Kurokawa frowned.
"I find that difficult to believe. The League has held ape-man prisoners before,"
he informed Sandra, startling her. But he hesitated before going on, an uncertain expression joining his frown.
"At least some survived to teach League spies their speech."
He pointed at Adar.
"He was the leader of your alliance, after Captain Reddy, of course," he said harshly. "And though I'm inclined to believe, as he insists, he's of little value as such now, no doubt my radio operators can learn his language as easily from you as him,"
he threatened.
"I may yet make use of him and do not want him to die. You're his doctor. Save him."
Sandra was still absorbing the implications of the fact that the League had Lemurian prisoners. The Allies transmitted in code groups, but had always felt secure using Lemurian for voice communications. No wonder the League knew so much. Her mind whirled. "You're keeping him? All the others in the same kind of cell as us?" she demanded of Muriname.
"Yes, but
Then that's your answer, Sandra snapped scornfully. The League must have kept their Lemurians confined in the open. They can't stand the kind of captivity you've had them in for long, and will die no matter what I do. Why do you think the Grik never keep Lemurian prisoners, or eat them as quick as they can when they get them? She felt fairly safe asking that. Kurokawa must have seen that for himself when he commanded all the Grik in India. Still, he snorted, and even Moriname looked skeptical.
Look at him, Sandra thundered. Do you think he's faking?
Kurokawa clasped his hands behind his back and appeared to think furiously. Finally, he barked at Moriname in Japanese.
We will prepare a compound, Moriname said grudgingly,
as if trying to envision how that would work in his mind. As far as Sandra had seen, they didn't have barbed wire.
Your men, Long and Horn, will construct a shelter within a fenced area we will build, he continued, with space out of doors.
He frowned.
We'll have to put you all in it together, he warned.
Such a place will require constant guards, and we can't spare enough to watch you separately.
Sandra shook her head. I don't care. They're our friends. They won't take advantage of us, she added, knowing Moriname, at least, might very well attempt it. He might even have been counting on their isolation to facilitate that. Sandra shuddered at the thought that 300 other men probably had the same idea. Much as she loathed him, Kurokawa was hers and Diania's only protection from that. For now. She looked back at Adar and finally saw a spark of recognition in his eyes.
No,
he rasped, barely audible.
You must not do this. I love you, Lady Sandra, but I want to die. I need to die.
What more do you require?
Kurokawa demanded, thankfully misinterpreting Adar's meaning and possibly alarmed by his determination. He'd helped create the Grik suicider flying bombs, but apparently even he considered Lemurians to be more like people than the Grik, or possibly the fact that four of them obviously preferred a terrible lingering death to what he must have considered a benign incarceration, even appealed to his ideal of the Bushido code he expected his men, if not necessarily himself, to follow. Or maybe he really did hope to use Adar. Fresh air, food, sunlight, and at least the illusion of space around them. That's the only thing that'll save them now.
Very well,
Kurokawa grunted, looking at Moriname. Then he repeated Sandra's own earlier thoughts, almost to the letter.
See to it. After all, they cannot escape. Where could they go?
Let me die,
Adar groaned, slightly louder, and Kurokawa thrust his round face near the drawn Lemurians.
If you die, she dies, Ape Man, he snapped. I have little enough reason to keep her alive as it is, apparently. So if you care for her, you'll recover.
Lady Sandra,
Adar gasped as they carried him into the darkness.
How could you? I was so close.
Shush, Mr. Chairman, she said sternly, then lowered her voice to a whisper when she kissed the matted fur on his cheek. We're not finished yet.
The guards took Adar away, and Kurokawa and Moriname stepped back inside. For just a moment, there was no one within earshot.
What you said, Diania hissed at Sandra. About Captain Reddy? You did not mean it. I wish I did, Sandra answered, her voice the merest murmur.
She sighed silently.
No, he'll come, she said with sad certainty. He'll have to, and not just for us. He'll do it for Balgpon Bay and however many other ships and people we lost.
She nodded at Savoy's malignant shadow in the gloom.
And he can't leave that behind him, in the hands of a maniac, to come after him at its leisure. But I was right about the other part. He'll do it smart, and he'll end Kurokawa this time, no matter what it takes or costs.
Chapter 1. Balkpan Borno, October 20, 1944.
God, I miss Idaho, mumbled Alan Letts, the newly appointed chairman of the United Homes, staring at the sloshy, muggy Balkpan afternoon. He had never thought he'd miss how cold it got in Stanley, or Grand Forks, North Dakota, either. That was another place he considered home after spending half his childhood there, but it was rarely anything but hot and wet in Balkpan, the capital city of the new union he had helped build. The daily shower had finally passed, and he and his wife, Karen, the assistant minister of medicine, stepped outside the main entrance to the Allied Naval Hospital east of the Great Hall. That was Karen's principal domain, and between her long hours and his crazy schedule, Alan sometimes gloomily suspected their little daughter, Allison Verdia, was the only child they'd ever get the chance to make. But at least he could see his youngling and mate, which was a hell of a lot more than most could say these days. So many younglings had at least one parent deployed, sometimes both. Alan tried to prevent the latter, but that had been a losing proposition from the start. Lemurians made no distinction between sexes when it came to military service, and that was probably the only reason they'd had the numbers to survive. But new regulations decreed that pregnant females returned home, period, and he tried to keep them as trainers as long as possible. Even so, there were a lot of orphans running around. The youngest went entirely naked, scampering about on all fours as often as not, their frizzy tails held high. A pack of them dashed through a puddle, splashing water and mud, before rocketing up a heavy wooden pier supporting an old-style above-ground structure built in the time before genuine fortifications protected the city from large predators and invading Grik. The younglings flowed through a window, raising alarmed, angry voices, then skittered down another pier to vanish in the bustle of the city. Alan laughed at the sight, but supposed it wasn't really funny. Lemurian younglings were boisterous by nature, and their antics were well tolerated by adults. In the past, however, they'd been equally well supervised. That was no longer the case, and they now ran in packs, almost as wild as Griklets. Alan tried to be philosophical about it. At least they didn't swarm all over people and eat them like Griklets. But even as they were losing an entire generation to the war, Alan feared they might lose the next one, too. Culturally, at least. "Mind your shoes," Karen scolded, as Alan carefully negotiated the planks laid down to the polka-drawn carriage outside the hospital. "And at least try to keep from making mud pies in your best whites. Maybe I don't have to clean them anymore." She flapped her own clean but dark-stained apron for emphasis. "But somebody does, and it's a chore nobody needs." Alan had been caught by the rain while visiting wounded cats and men, something he did every week, and he didn't mind that the deluge had delayed his busy schedule, heartrending as it often was to speak with the shattered victims of this terrible war, or simply view those who couldn't even hear him. It also filled him with hope that, despite their pain, so many Lemurians, and humans from the Empire of the New Britain Isles, for the most part, remained so dedicated to the cause. Indeed, most were eager to return to the fight, regardless of how unlikely that might be in many cases. "They'll get back in somehow," Alan promised himself, as he had promised them. "Even if they never see the front again, we need instructors, engineers, and shop foremen who've been at the pointy end and seen what works. We may have lost their direct combat skills, but we can't afford to lose their experience. God knows, we need them." "I'll try," Alan assured, stepping into the carriage and nodding at the Cat Marine on the front seat, holding the reins. The Lemurian made a curious chirping sound and whipped the reins. Moaning rebelliously, the polka squished forward. Alan swayed, still looking at Karen and the hospital behind her. The hospital wasn't as large as the great factories, now crowding the Balkpan waterfront, once so charming with colorful, bustling bazaars and brisk commerce.
but it was the biggest building past the Great Hall in Balgpon proper. That was a source of pride, as well as sadness. It said a lot about how committed his people were to helping those who served them. His expression turned stony then, because as much as his visits to the hospital inspired him, they also renewed his resolve to exact vengeance against those who had caused so much suffering in the first place. All of them, he secretly swore, with a fresh stab of furious grief over the sinking of SMS America and 2/3 of the wounded she carried by the shadowy League of Tripoli. Some of America's survivors had finally reached Balgpon, and between their accounts and what Matt sent from Grik City, they had a better idea of what happened and of what the League was, even if its motives remained obscure. 3 wars now? Alan mused grimly. No, not yet. Not if we can help it. We can barely handle the 2 we've got. But there'll be a reckoning. And put on your hat, Karen admonished, raising her voice and gesturing at the sky. The sun was stabbing through the clouds, raising steam from the sodden ground. Alan Letts had a very fair complexion and burned easily. He didn't spend as much time outdoors these days and sometimes forgot to protect himself. Yes, dear, he called back dutifully, quickly adjusting his high, tight collar and plopping the white hat on his head. I'll see you and the girls tonight, he added, finally sitting as the carriage lurched onto the main gravel-mixed street. For all the younglings running loose, even more had been adopted by females working in the shipyards or factories, both Lemurians and expat imperial women. Some families, with the wherewithal, still intact because they ran businesses essential to the war effort and weren't allowed to fight, had adopted 6 or more. Alan and Karen had taken 2 themselves, both female, and treated them as their own. They would have taken more, but their duties already required that they have a nanny, a young, one-armed Marine veteran of the Battle of Rangoon named Una Sanmar, with 3 younglings of her own. For the first time, he noticed the many furry Lemurian faces watching from the newly built ground-level shops and porches lining the road, their amused but respectful blinking still coming as a surprise. They actually enjoy that I'm henpecked, he realized with a mental snort. Then he reconsidered. But maybe that's why they've accepted me. It makes me more a person to them, regardless of what species I am. Alan still found his official status as the leader of the new, wildly diverse nation they had built a bit overwhelming and more than a little unbelievable. True, he had been accepted as acting chairman during Adar's absence, and the members of the Grand Alliance, including the Empire of the New Britain Isles and the Republic of Real People, which hadn't joined the Union, were accustomed to that. He even thought he had done a good job under the circumstances, managing the logistical side of the war effort in particular, but he had never dreamed he'd be practically drafted into the job for real after Adar fell into enemy hands. It might have been easier to understand if he had just been acclaimed High Chief of Balgpon. He was well known there, and even, as were all his surviving shipmates from USS Walker, USS Mahan, and S-19, to various degrees, beloved. They had saved the city, after all. But the fact they'd also, literally or by extension, saved Arial, Bimbaudo, Batava, North Borno, Sembakpan, Sular, Austral, Chilchap, the Shogunate of Yokohama, which included the tragic village of Aniaki, and all the Philpin lands, not to mention the 11 seagoing homes that had joined the Union, apparently hadn't been lost on anyone. Though still amazingly fractious, particularly in the case of Sular, which still argued over representation after all the seagoing homes joined as a single, relatively high population state, the various homes had apparently recognized the validity of some version of the old axiom, never change horses in the middle of the stream, or war. It also probably helped that Alan came from the one home or clan that every other had to materially support and considered most impartial, the American Navy Clan. It not only protected everyone, but most of its members now came from every clan or home. They swore allegiance to its flag and a constitution that had served as a guide for the one adopted by the Union, but though their loyalty to its high chief, Captain Matthew Reddy, was unquestioned, everyone knew they remained loyal to the United Homes as well. In addition, every Union warship belonged to the American Navy Clan except those designated as reserve, such as Salamana or Salisa, CV-1, and an increasing number of auxiliaries entering service. It was no longer required that all sailors join the American Navy Clan forever, but officers must in order to be commissioned. Regular sailors' oaths would be allowed to expire, if they wanted, when the war was over and they went home. But the Marines practically belonged to Captain Reddy. The Navy Clan also had a few land possessions, such as the islands of Tarakan, Midway, and Andaman. And there was a daughter colony being built at a place called San Diego, so far away that it was literally on the bottom of the world as far as most were concerned. Even that didn't cause disputes because all contributed solely to the maintenance of the Navy and would never become independent homes. Alan often wondered to himself if the mishmash they had put together would survive the war. He also worried that the unusual powers he had helped reserve for the Navy Clan might be abused by some future high chief after they were gone. He hoped not. He hoped the tradition of selfless service Matt and the others had established at such a terrible cost would last a very long time. Either way, though, for now at least, the American Navy Clan, as the one most responsible for the conduct of the war, had to remain a very slight first among equals, even as it truly was viewed as the most neutral when it came to disputes among other homes. He stuck two fingers in the collar at his neck and pulled. "Damn thing's getting tighter as I sweat," he grumped to himself. "What the hell was wrong with my khakis?" It was his wife's idea that he always wear his best whites in public. Despite his complaints, he supposed it made sense. He was the chairman, practically president, for God's sake. After all, he should try to look the part. "And at least whites don't show sweat like khakis," he conceded. "But maybe most important, the uniform's a good recruiting tool. We need more people than ever to crew the ships and fly the planes we're building and fill the ranks of our armies." Conscription had been instituted in the Empire of the New Britain Isles and now in the Republic of Real People as well, but nothing like that had been proposed in the homes forming the new Union simply because, once the war practically surrounded them, there was no place left for runaways to go. Particularly after the battles of Arial and Balkpan, that was when it was driven brutally home that there weren't any non-combatants, and it became understood that every person, male or female, capable of bearing arms and living under the protection of the Alliance from the Malay Barrier to the Philippine Lands, was a member of a local guard. Even factory workers attended daily drill sessions, usually at work, and fell in for a larger unit instruction once a month in the open killing grounds beyond the ever-expanding earthen walls protecting the cities. Armories stocked with old-style muskets were conveniently situated, and factory and yard workers were assigned defensive positions close to where they worked. That was all well and good, but though anyone was theoretically subject to being called up and sent to an advanced training center and assigned to a building regiment or shipped off to replace casualties, it almost never happened. They needed workers as badly as troops. The addition of the Great South Isle, or Austral, to the Union would help a great deal eventually. The populous homes there had remained an untapped reservoir of potential sailors, soldiers, and labor for most of the war. Now they were in it, and though most had to stay and build their own factories and defend their cities, many wanted to fight for their people and their new nation. Getting them here or anywhere was a major problem, however. The Allied sea lift capacity was stretched to the breaking point, supplying forces in the east and west, halfway around the world. And Austral didn't have the same nautical mindset of other homes in the Union. Their huge island was lush and fertile, on this world, and never depended as much on the sea. They had a few decent shipyards, but it was taking time for them to gear up, and there was no point in building more old-style ships like they were used to, in any event. They'd agreed to focus on heavy haulers and auxiliaries, based on the hull design of the Scott-class steam frigates, but half again as big. In the meantime, Allied seagoing homes ponderously freighted steam engines down to Austral shipyards and just as tediously returned with loads of volunteers. Alan considered it his duty to, by example, get those recruits to choose the Navy or Marines. Besides, he thought, wearing the uniform lets me remind everyone that I belong to the American Navy clan. And, chairman or not, whether I currently outrank him or not, Captain Reddy's still my high chief. The carriage slowed as it passed the growing military cemetery on the shady grounds surrounding the Great Hall, and finally stopped. The Great Hall was once supported high in the air by the massive gala tree growing up within it, but had expanded down to the ground. Alan was running late for his rendezvous with Lord Bolton Forrester, ambassador from the Empire of the New Britain Isles, but the tall, gray-haired man with a huge mustache stood from a bench on the hall's porch and smiled up at Alan. Forrester's aide, Lieutenant Bachman, had been pacing on the carefully fitted timbers, watched by a relatively short and wiry and also apparently amused man named Henry Stokes. Stokes had been a leading seaman aboard HMAS Perth and was now director of the Office of Strategic Intelligence, OSI. Alan remained in the carriage as a pair of Lemurian Marines escorted the men to join him, ready to assist them up if necessary.
"Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman," the Imperial Ambassador said through a grin behind his mustache, climbing up with an agility that belied his years.
"It's still just Alan, unless you want me calling you Lord Forrester again," Alan replied dryly.
"Oh, no, Bolton's the name."
He sat opposite Alan and leaned forward.
"I confess some difficulty resisting the urge to rub it in, as it were, however. I apologize."
You shouldn't be sorry," Stokes said, hopping up and sitting next to Alan.
He was quickly followed by Bachman, who stiffly folded himself on the bench beside Forrester.
"He needs to get used to it and quit maundering about, wishing he was just a simple sailor again. He ain't," Stokes continued. "Bloke's the bloody chairman, and needs to act like it, including letting folks be polite to him."
Alan shook his head and glared at Stokes, wondering if the Australian could read minds. There was no doubt he was well-suited to his intelligence role, probably better than Commander Simon Herring had been. Herring had always seemed more interested in the process of his game rather than achieving results, with one possible exception. The two Marines climbed on the back of the carriage, and Alan instructed the driver to proceed. The polka mooed, and the carriage trundled forward.
"I let people be polite," he defended. "Hell, I'm polite, but it'll take time to get used to all this. With respect, Mr. Chairman, you ain't got time," Stokes stated simply. "Not any."
Forrester frowned.
"I doubt it's of any great importance how we address one another as friends, but Mr. Stokes has a point. My own Governor Empress was thrust into an arguably more difficult situation than yours. At least you enjoy a measure of domestic stability, after all. She,"
he nodded at Alan,
"with the help of Captain Reddy, of course, survived an attempt on her life, the loss of both parents and the destruction of her entire government. This, immediately after our country was plunged into wars, both foreign and domestic."
He rubbed his chin thoughtfully as they moved into what remained of the old commercial district.
"She kept things together largely by insisting the proprieties be observed, even as she fundamentally reworked the empire around her. She couldn't have succeeded without help from our allies," he conceded, "or if she'd shown the slightest indecision, or, frankly, flexibility."
Always objective when it came to analysis, Stokes nodded at Forrester.
"Not to be a knocker, but that hasn't worked as well lately, if you'll pardon me saying."
Forrester grimaced.
Combined with the impetuosity of youth, she did perhaps allow her inflexibility to overrule the better judgment of more experienced minds,"
he allowed, acknowledging the debacle that led to the naval battle of Malpelo, against the twisted forces of the Holy Dominion. In hindsight, the battle had been a great victory, as had General Shinya and 10th Corps' desperate defense of Fort Defiance. It even appeared a turning point may have been reached in the war against the Doms, but that was in spite of Governor Empress Rebecca Ann MacDonald's decisions, not because of them. She had done a great deal to rectify her errors, helping the situation do perhaps a bit better than simply stabilize, but her inflexibility had undoubtedly cost lives. Alan threw his hands up. "So you both give me hell about being too familiar, then tell me I'll lose us the war if I'm too imperious. Which is it?"
Both, I suppose," Forrester said.
Stokes nodded agreement. Alan avoided rolling his eyes in frustration and changed the subject instead.
"So, Bolton," he began, stressing the ambassador's first name,
"how was your visit to the lovely, friendly paradise of Sular?"
Forrester rolled his own eyes and began relating his latest discussions with the most recalcitrant member of the Union. He may not have been a citizen of the United Homes, but it was in his nation's best interest that the Union thrive, and Alan often used him as a trusted, objective go-between. The carriage slowed again as it moved through crowds of workers coming off shift, even as others headed in the opposite direction. Most were Lemurians, of course, their furry coats dingy from long hours at machines or forges, their large-eyed faces slack with fatigue, tails hanging low. Quite a few were human females, however, generally dark-haired and skinned, averaging about 5 feet 5 inches tall. They were the expat impi gals, who'd come to Balgpan in the Philpin lands before Governor Empress MacDonald emancipated them, nullifying the indentures many labored under. Some went home after that, but most remained. This was home now, and they were just as much citizens of Balgpan, the Philpin lands, even the American Navy clan, as anyone else. They were weary, too, often performing work, difficult even for Lemurians, but they were free and helping the cause with determination. The thing that struck Alan most was, in spite of their exhausting labor and the prospect of more for those heading to work, everyone's morale seemed good. Many even tiredly cheered when his carriage passed. This, after word had already spread about the sinking of SMS America by yet another potential foe and the terrible losses they'd sustained in the battle with Kurokawa north of Mahe.
"They still trust us to pull this off, to win in the end," Alan thought. "They still trust me. One way or another, I'll earn it, no matter what," he swore.
"I don't know how you've done it,"
Forrester said softly, interrupting his discourse on Sular and apparently echoing Alan's thoughts about the people here.
"What?"
Alan asked, falsely cheerful. Many Lemurians spoke some English now, but they'd never hear his words over the ruckus, regardless of how good their ears were. They'd hear his tone, though.
"How we've killed a generation and sparked a population explosion of another that'll never know the culture we destroyed or even their own parents?"
"No," Forrester said.
"How you saved them despite the rest. They're fully aware of that, I assure you," he added.
Alan said nothing more. Past the old rope walks, now a factory making thousands of wooden barrels and hundreds of wheels for heavy freight wagons and artillery pieces every week, they turned right to parallel a loud, smoky battery of oil-fired steam generators, providing electric power to a pair of huge machine shops on either side. As sad as it genuinely made him that they had turned this almost idyllic city into a massive industrial complex, Alan could never suppress a lurking sense of wonder at all they'd accomplished. What began as his own little Ministry of Industry and Sonny Campetti's Ordnance Division, which attempted to manage a wide variety of relatively small enterprises, with the exception of the refineries, shipyards, foundries, and ammunition works they'd geared up at once, had morphed into a blossoming, if chaotic, manufacturing infrastructure. Not only here, but at Manila and in the Empire as well. The shipyards were the most evident example of that, and from the vantage point of the carriage, they'd grown to encompass nearly everything, and the Balpan metalworks was now inextricably combined with them. Under the ownership of two brothers, it had expanded from its pre-war capacity of making crude, non-ferrous castings to pouring complex iron castings for every manner of thing, and was getting tolerably good steel from Madras. It had multiple divisions of its own, including steel mills, rolling mills, tubing and pipe mills, as well as facilities for making wire and wire cables. The Balpan Boiler and Steam Engine Works made arguably better boilers and engines than they'd first copied, and they'd been surpassed by similar works in Manila and the Empire in terms of output, as had the Balpan Ice Houses, which made internal combustion engines. Those here were still amazingly productive, but focused more on innovation than quantity. This was where they had pioneered the new radial aircraft engines and steam turbines, for example, because Balpan had made the longest strides in specialty steel production and treatment. That had been a conscious planning decision, not only to spread the load, but also to build in future competition. With the ratification of the Constitution, it was agreed that all manufacturing facilities would, someday, be broken into competing companies. Letts had worked hard for that, since the labor and treasure of all the people had gone into making them, those same people who had worked so hard for so long before they were even paid would have shares they could keep or sell. It would be a nightmare to implement, but it was the right thing to do, not only for the people, but also for the future. Competition was good. That would have to wait, however. The powder mills and magazine complexes, now situated on the other side of the bay, northeast of the Balpan ATC, were frighteningly monstrous. But there was redundancy now. Most industrial homes or land-based states in the alliance had powder mills of their own, and numerous secure magazines. The Grik Zeppelin raid on Balpan hadn't hit the one they'd had at the time, but that was sheer luck. They'd never risk such a devastating blow again by keeping all their explosive eggs in one basket. The only exception to that was the smokeless propellant works on Samar. There weren't enough Saarns, a race of Grik-like Pacific Islanders that Sankakcha, the high chief of the Philpinlands, had taken in, to expect them to contribute troops. Only one, with the unlikely name of Lawrence, was currently under arms for the Union. But in their gratitude to Sankakcha, the Saarans desperately wanted to be of use and actually lobbied to have the dangerous installation built in their midst. The fact that Samar was overrun with a kind of plant that produced an ideal type of cellulose for the project was advantageous, and there'd be other installations of the type soon, in Sular and on Respite Island, importing the gun cotton plants from Samar. But the demand for regular gunpowder still surpassed the need for the smokeless variety, and probably would for some time to come. The Balpan, Manila, and now Imperial naval arsenals were responsible for making everything from small arms, such as the trapdoor Allen Silva breech-loading rifles, carbines, and shotguns, to torpedoes, mortars, bombs, and ever-larger naval rifles. With the associated heavy lathes required, they were also tasked with making other large machined parts, such as propeller shafts. Each of these endeavors, and those devoted to making the new automatic weapons, pistols, bayonets, cutlasses, and even canteens and helmets, was under the supervision of various division chiefs, as was the production of the thankfully small variety of fixed ammunition for all standard weapons. Allen imagined dismally that they had several regiments' worth of division chiefs alone, scattered around the alliance. Napoleon was wrong, he realized. Armies don't move on their stomachs. They slide along on the slippery heaps of paper bureaucrats excrete like brontosauri shit. How the hell did we manage all this before we even had paper? In addition to reporting to ordnance, each division made duplicate reports to the Ministry of Industry and Supply, which coordinated the production of all other combat gear, from shoes and sandals to field smocks, cartridge boxes, rations and medical supplies, transport wagons, and field comm gear. And then, of course, there were the thousands of little things that troops needed in the field, like shelter. Alan still managed to find a measure of ironic amusement that all their cat soldiers and marines slept under shelter half-pup tents. But each of those had to have stakes, ropes. Oh, the list was endless. Finally, supply had to figure out who needed what, when, and where, and arrange to get it there. That had been Alan's primary job before his acclimation to chairman, and the one he missed least of all. The only reason any of this is working, he thought, as Ambassador Forrester continued to describe the self-serving shenanigans of the Salarans, besides the fact we're in an existential war, is because stuff is so cheap. He'd helped institute a financial system more than a year before, the first the Lemurians had ever really known. Before that, their various economies were based on barter and carefully tabulated indebtedness founded on numerous standards. The closest they'd come to the gold standard in use in the Empire of the New Britain Isles, and that Alan had roughly copied here, was a barrel of Grikaka oil as a reference for relative value. But with so much dependent on petroleum now, Grikaka oil was in the tank. It still made better lamp oil and flux for a wide variety of natural lubricants, including bullet lube, but the industry was probably almost as dead as the sea monsters they killed to get it. But metal. Any metal had real value, and gold, being the most durable of all, and least useful for turning into bullets, blades, and airplane engines, set the standard for the relative representative value of other metals that could be made into things. Copper, iron, zinc, lead, all had value relative to their weight in gold, and gold was the money they exchanged in their place. The most valuable metal in the world, for example, was aluminum, worth 10 times its weight in gold. They needed it for a number of very specific things, primarily to do with aircraft, and simply couldn't make it yet, if ever. All they had was what remained of the old PBY Catalina, a few wrecked P-40s, an old Betty bomber they'd found crashed in the jungle of Borno, and a few other curious relics that turned up from time to time. Not long before, for example, a prospecting team recovered the carcass of a P-40 lost in the raid on Madras. They had been looking for it specifically and had a good idea where it was, but then another team discovered the wreckage of a Japanese dive bomber on the southwest coast of Java, near Chilchap. So there was always hope that other leakers from another war-torn world might appear. And, as Alan noted, things were cheap, at least for now. The economy of Forrester's Empire of the New Britain Isles had been pretty much in the crapper, and it would have been virtually impossible for them to go on if not for a number of factors. First, they were in an existential war as well, and that tended to make people more flexible when it came to what they were willing to sacrifice for the cause. Second, Rebecca Ann MacDonald had assumed almost dictatorial powers in the wake of the treachery of the so-called Honorable New Britain Company, and members of her own court of directors and court of proprietors. The mass murder of most of the loyalists within her government had left her little choice. She had seized the assets of the company and all those implicated in the treason. Then, as a gift, the Western Allies informed Her Majesty where large oil and gold deposits might be found within the bounds of the imperial colony in North America, centered near a bay city they called St. Francis. That reserve gave the Empire much-needed credit to draw upon. Most Lemurians, on the other hand, had always considered themselves well off if they had enough to eat. Now there was plenty. The great sea-going homes still brought in Grikaka, for meat primarily, and many sold their huge fish harvests on a daily basis. The great ships themselves were virtually independent of land and needed money only to replace things that broke or to make necessary repairs. As reserve navy ships, they had access to the repair yards for things like that. Hunters scoured the wilds of Borno for rhino pigs that never seemed to decrease in numbers, and some Lemurians had actually begun raising them and other wild beasts. The vast killing grounds beyond the fortifications had been planted with crops as well, initiating the first large-scale agricultural effort Lemurians had ever attempted. A lot of food went to the war effort, of course, but there were no shortages at home. Luxuries weren't unknown to Lemurians, but they weren't very important just now. That would change eventually, Alan suspected, especially after the war was won. But in the meantime, there was little for anyone to spend their pay on, and no reason to complain that it wasn't greater. Beyond the waterfront machine shops, incongruously, was a long, open-sided tavern called the Busted Screw. Over time, it had become as much a fixture on the Balgpon Wharf as the teeming bazaars had been. The place was packed, as usual, with yard workers, sailors, and marines, but few were there to drink. The Screw's principal owner, a cat called Pepper, charged more than the factory commissaries, but his chow was better. So was the entertainment, for cats and men. The Screw still served beer and seep, but only to workers showing time cards, proving they weren't due back at work for more than 6 hours, and sailors and marines had to show their liberty cards. The Screw's personality changed considerably after dark, but food was still available for the night shifts. Alan shook his head. Pepper was a character who'd been one of Earl Lanier's cook's mates on Walker, and Lanier remained an absent partner in the Screw. But Pepper had other business interests, not all entirely savory. His partnership with Isaac Rubin and Gilbert Yeager, for instance, to make the nasty, waxy Areal and tobacco fit to smoke, would probably get them all lynched if word got out that they stripped the leaves with a process involving the urine of the pygmy brontosauris indigenous to Borno. Alan arched his eyebrows thoughtfully. Then again, probably not. Too many people, cats and humans, are already too addicted to their vile pig cigs to shut down supply. He'd have to have a word with Pepper about modifying his process, however. Finally, they worked their way past another engine powering the first of many heavy cranes along a busy dock, and for the first time they had an unobstructed view of the old fitting-out pier in Balgpon Bay beyond. The bay was packed with shipping of every description, some under sail and others coughing smoke from tall funnels. Small feluccas darted to and fro, carrying passengers or small cargo from one part of the harbor to another. But dominating the scene were three monstrous sea-going homes. Two were moored some distance out, while the third had maneuvered past them with its great sweep oars. Its three massive wings, semi-rigid junk-like sails rising up tripod masts, enclosing the pagoda-like quarters of its people, were starting to draw the mid-afternoon breeze. Soon the sweeps would be secured and the whole 1,000-foot-long monster would move, slowly, under wind power alone. "A stirring sight," Forrester said, loud enough to be heard over the engine noises and voices around them. "Yeah," Alan agreed, embarrassedly aware he had tuned out Forrester some time ago. No doubt the ambassador knew it and understood why. Alan was barely 25 and had an awful lot to wrap his head around. Just then he was remembering the first time he'd seen one of the immense sea-going homes. "Big Sal was one of those once," he said a little sadly. "So was Araka. Now they're aircraft carriers. The biggest ones we have, along with Maki Cat." Maka Kakja was the Manila-built carrier damaged at Malpelo while fighting the Doms. Though a purpose-built carrier, she had the same hull form and dimensions as a home. "And of the four first-generation fleet carriers we built, New Dublin and Rangoon are finally heading east from Manila to join Second Fleet and help High Admiral Jenks against the Doms. Madras is steaming west to join First Fleet." He took a deep breath. "And Balgpon Bay's on the bottom of the sea," he said, then added to their driver, "We'll stop here." When the carriage swayed to a halt, the four men and two cat marines stepped out. "New Dublin?" Forrester queried, surprised. That was the name of a once rebellious city on the Imperial Island of New Ireland.
"Don't misunderstand. I'm not ungrateful for your country's generosity, and two carriers and the escorts we've completed at Scapa Flow will give me greater confidence we can hold what we've gained against the damnable Doms. But perhaps I don't understand your naming conventions."
"We name carriers for battles," Alan told him.
"And destroyers for bloody heroes," Stokes adjoined. We didn't in His Majesty's navies, but it seems fitting.
Ah,
Forrester cleared his throat.
Indeed.
The pier they stood on was the old one in name only, having been badly damaged once and rebuilt three times. The newer fitting-out piers and shipyards to the north were larger, but were still almost entirely devoted to building wooden hulls. Some were quite large and would become the latest, again slightly smaller, class of fleet carriers, as well as cargo ships, oilers, and essentially everything they wanted Astral to start making. Bigger, dedicated steam-powered auxiliaries would help with many things. They'd require smaller crews, carry heavier loads, and get them where they were needed faster. Only that would help get a handle on their supply problems. But while the empire of the New Britain Isles was finally hitting its stride, building screw-propeller, iron-armored wooden warships, the Western Alliance had gone all in with steel-hulled designs for combat vessels. And now that they knew how, and materials were available in larger quantities, they were quicker to make. Not only did they require less skilled labor, but it also wasn't necessary to cut the wood, freight it in, trim it, and lay it up to dry, or dry it themselves, which on the scale they were building required a process nearly as extensive as making steel in the first place. Three steel ships were currently fitting out, floating high in the water at the pier, and the skeletons of more were rising on the ways nearby. The closest two hulls looked just like Walker's and those of the two other new destroyers that had already deployed. Unfortunately, one of those was already lost as well. And hulls were about all these were, as yet. The closest had been decked, and the foundations for the bridge structure and aft deckhouse stood incongruously square atop it. But the skylights over the engineering spaces gaped empty. Workers operated windlasses and heaved on taglines secured to a large, complexly shaped object suspended from a crane. The next ship seemed slightly farther along, and a couple of hundred yards down the pier was yet another, similar, larger shape that looked almost complete. Two Lemurian naval officers practically ran to meet them, but Alan smiled and waved them away after returning their salutes.
As you were, we're just here to gawk.
Aye, aye, Mr. Chairman,
one said.
But please watch your steppings.
He waved at the crane and the extremely heavy-looking iron thing hanging from it.
Is stuff squash you all everywhere, even in air?
We'll be careful, Alan assured.
Don't let us distract you. The cats nodded skeptically and backed away, leaving the four men watching the object sway down toward the closest hull.
That's one of our reduction gear boxes, Alan told Forrester proudly. And you'll be hard-pressed to imagine anything requiring more precision. Maybe a gun director or TDC. But reduction gears take a lot more abuse. They're what transfer the rotation of the turbines to the screws.
Forrester shaded his eyes.
Well, it seems a rather crude housing, he objected.
And I thought the turbines were the most difficult part of copying Walker's power plant.
The geared turbine drive, Lord Forrester, Stokes stressed. And the turbines themselves were tough enough, even with examples to look at. We had to make good nickel steel first, which we needed for proper automatic weapons and naval rifles anyway. And then we had to relearn how to heat treat the stuff.
He grinned.
You've been watching us go through those labor pains, and we've given you reports on everything we did to share with the Empire. Suffice to say, we made them, but you can't use them as efficiently without reduction gears. Unlike reciprocating engines, they get all their torque from their high speed.
He saw that Forrester still looked unconvinced.
Don't let that casing fool you. There's nothing crude inside it.
They're what took us so long to get the first new DDs out to the fleet, Alan confirmed. Then shook his head and held his hand up, thumb and forefinger almost touching. Even with the rest of the first ships already built, we were that close to starting from scratch on their power plants, trying turbo electrics or something like that. Some wanted to go direct drive and take the efficiency hit, or put reciprocating engines in them and settle for 20 knots, but Captain Reddy told us we might as well do it right. And he was right. We needed the technological kick in the ass making those things gave us. We've been building guns, engines, even torpedoes, and our tooling still wasn't precise enough. We lost our best metallurgist, a guy named Dave Eldon, in the battle out there. He pointed at the bay. Fortunately, he'd already written down a lot of stuff, but our people still had to relearn it. And Courtney Bradford and Ben Mallory helped too, he added. Both were engineers in fields that use special metals, petroleum and aeronautics. He shrugged. But when it came to actually making the gears, we had an ace up our sleeve we didn't even know about. A guy named Charlie Murphy. Forrester raised his eyebrows. Another prisoner who survived Mizuki Maru and the Japs, Alan explained. He'd been a machinist on the subtender Canopus in Manila Bay. The old, he stopped. Even Stokes had only recently learned the story of how, bombed out and listing, Canopus and her machinists fixed or made everything imaginable, not only for her subs sneaking in and out, but for anything else needed on Corregidor before it fell. And she did it all at night, setting smoke pots and pretending to be sunk and abandoned in shallow water during the day. Anyway, Letts said, Murphy's one hell of a machinist. Even so, he had to do a lot of hand-turning and milling, constantly checking his work with calipers, all while teaching others to take the same care he did. He designed jigs. He stopped again. Long story.
I'd love to meet him, Bolton Forrester said.
Alan waved east. He's back in the Philippine lands now, helping with other stuff. He smiled. Maybe you can borrow him in the Empire someday. That guy's never getting close to anything that'll shoot him, stick him, or eat him, if I have anything to say about it. He nodded back at the gearbox. Building the first of those was like making giant watches. He gave an exasperated snort. And then we had to torture them to death. I don't even want to think about how many units we shredded before we got the bugs worked out. But we've got the tooling now, for them and other stuff, and a whole shop dedicated to making one complete unit a week. Just like the ice houses make nothing but the same engine they're contracted to build one after another. He waved at the crane and chuckled. Funny thing is, ordinarily you'd install something like that before you even launched a ship. But we had so much trouble with the first ones, taking them out and putting them back so many times. The yard apes like it this way better. They're even kind of superstitious about it. Bachman surprised them all by speaking, rather hesitantly. But will that thing, designed for these... He waved the narrow hull the crane was lowering the gearbox toward. Work in a larger ship? Alan smiled. Interesting you should ask, Lieutenant. He nodded down the pier and began to walk. Watch your steppings, gentlemen. The second DD had the amidships deckhouse nearly finished and the aft searchlight tower erected. It also rode lower in the water. And, Alan explained, that was because all her machinery was in place. As on the first one, cats romped all over it, pulling air hoses, driving rivets, and grinding rivet heads amid great yellow sparkling arcs. Forrester and Bachman appeared amazed by how fast the new ships were going together, and Forrester even said as much. Yeah, they built USS Ward, one of Walker's sisters, in 17.5 days at the Mare Island Navy Yard, back home, Alan told them. And it took less than 3 months from keel laying to commissioning. That was a big deal at the time, he conceded. And they weren't even fighting monsters that'd eat them if they lost the war. They were going as fast as they could, though, to see what they could do. So are we, and our shipyard workforce, at least, is almost unlimited. He frowned at Stokes. Maybe too unlimited, at the expense of other projects? That probably sounds strange coming from me, but we'll see. He nodded back at the DDs, and his frown faded. Still, we haven't already built 100 of the damn things to the point where the guys can slap them together in their sleep, and we're still making stuff to make stuff better. I'll consider it just as big a deal if these are ready to go in 3 more months.
That will still be quite a feat, Forrester agreed with a touch of envy as they continued on.
But then their eyes fell on the third ship, secured to the pier, and Forrester barked a laugh.
Your cruiser! He said gleefully. I haven't seen her since the launch.
Oh, you weren't in Sular that long, Alan objected. He started to say that she could be seen from the Great Hall, but that hadn't been true for quite a while. Only a small sliver of the bay, due west, was visible from there anymore. There was simply too much in the way now. And we were on the bay together 2 weeks ago when we visited the ATC, he said, remembering. You didn't even look this way?
No,
Forrester confessed.
You may recall we were all a bit, preoccupied that day. And otherwise,
he held his hands out at his sides.
Between one thing and another, I just haven't been down to see her. My, she's a lovely thing. And nearly complete.
Well, almost nearly, Alan qualified. There's still a lot to do. To a casual observer, the new cruiser looked almost identical to USS Walker, except it was bigger, with a higher freeboard even than the empty DD they'd first seen. But the pilot house looked similar. There were four stacks and an amidships deckhouse, and a rather large aft deckhouse as well. A more careful look revealed the pilot house was higher than Walker's and rested atop another deck. Two gun mounts squatted in front of it instead of one, with pairs of muzzles protruding from splinter shields. The second mount was higher than the first, just forward of the pilot house. Ordinary-looking DP 4-inch 50s stood on either beam atop the amidships deckhouse, and another pair stood in tubs behind the quadruple torpedo mounts flanking the aft two funnels. A tall crane with a searchlight platform on top jutted behind the fourth funnel. Two empty seaplane catapults dominated the space from there to the aft deckhouse, which was crowned by yet a third protected two-gun mount. Finally, a fifth DP 4-inch 50 poked up from the cramped fantail between a pair of depth charge racks. Probably the most obvious difference between the cruiser and its inspiration, however, was a tall tripod mast forward, where Walker's foremast would have been, with what looked like a smaller version of the square-windowed pilot house high in the air. Topping that was another pair of searchlights and the obligatory crow's nest near the top of the mast.
Oh my! Forrester murmured, peering upward and imagining what it must be like in the small tub all alone so high above the ship.
You use the same reduction gears in her?
Bachman asked.
The very same, Stokes confirmed. Only she has three of them, and three turbines to drive her. Two outboard and one on the center line. She can cruise on that one and save fuel, gives her longer range.
I saw she had three screw propellers when she launched, Forrester remembered aloud. Will that truly make that much difference? And with the same engines as the smaller ships, will she not be considerably slower?
We hope it'll make a difference, Alan hedged. James Ellis sustained 36 knots on her trials, with engines built in Balgpon. That's faster than Walker ever was. Will her engines last as long as Walker's have? He held his hands up, then dropped them. Who knows? We have identified a lot of inefficiencies. We think we fixed on those. He nodded toward the DDs under construction. Either way, except for some nagging quality control issues with tubes, I believe we built better boilers than Walker or Mahan ever had. He blinked fondly at the Lemurians working on the ship.
Those little guys can be awful imaginative when you give them a chance. They're never satisfied now they've got machines on their mind. They seem to constantly think, well, if this works good, why don't we do this too?
He arched an eyebrow.
Well, sometimes it works. Anyway, once Walker's repaired, she should still work up to 28 knots or so. Oh, I'd love to get her here and put brand new boilers in her.
He glanced at the cruiser.
She's got 8 boilers spinning 3 turbines. Should make 28 knots at least.
I'm glad to hear it, Forrester said.
Still somewhat skeptical, Alan thought.
But how can that work?
Alan shrugged and began to recite the cruiser's specifications by way of explanation. Her hull shape's almost literally an upscaled version of Walker's. She'll probably roll just as bad, but they're damn clean lines. She's 440 feet long with a 45-foot beam. Fully loaded and ready to fight, she'll displace around 4,000 tons. He nodded at Forrester, anticipating his next question.
Yeah, 3 times as much as Walker, so it'll take her longer to start and stop, but it won't put much more strain on our engines to keep her at speed. At least that's the theory. And with that centerline screw right in front of the rudder, she'll turn even tighter.
One of the limiting factors on Walker's speed has always been her boilers more than her engines. He rubbed his nose.
And age and hard use, of course.
He nodded at the new ship. The math comes out like this. We're figuring on between 23 and 26,000 shaft horsepower. We don't have the instruments to measure precisely, but it's close based on what Walker's engines were rated at and the performance of the new DDs. Add three shafts together and we come up with at least 69,000. The old Brit C-class CLs of the last war? He hesitated, looking at Forrester. Though somewhat British by descent and culture, it was pointless to describe a class of ships built 150 years after Forrester's ancestors came to this world, possibly from another world entirely, where C-class light cruisers may never have happened at all. The multiple lines of history that seem to have converged here often made things difficult to explain or comprehend, and trying to do either always made Alan's head hurt. Skip it, he said. Anyway, these other ships, of similar hull shape, length, and displacement, got nearly 30 knots out of about 40,000 SHP. He realized he had lost Forrester entirely. Skip it, he said again, and sighed. We're pretty sure. Forrester cleared his throat, then smiled and waved at the ship.
Well, he said, she certainly looks formidable.
She is, by most standards, Alan agreed, but his enthusiasm was suddenly waning.
By any standard, she's a hell of an achievement, Stokes stressed.
He pointed.
She's got 6 5.5-inch guns, all tied to a calibrated gun director, copied from a Magi. We went with the 5.5s because we're already making ammunition in liners for them, for the salvaged Jap secondaries on Sandy Cat and the others. They're bag guns and won't shoot as fast as 4-inch 50s, but they'll shoot farther and hit more than twice as hard. She's also got 5 dual-purpose 4-inch 50s, as you can see, which will help against aerial targets. We're working hard to design a proper anti-air fire control system after what happened at TF Alden.
He frowned and looked at Alan.
Nobody saw that coming, and it was my job to expect it.
His tone sounded more scolding than contrite. He looked back at Forrester.
She's getting the first new 50 cals as well, a full dozen of the bloody things, and 6 twin mounts. That'll help, too.
He gestured aft.
And she'll carry 8 torpedoes and 2 Nancy float planes. The aft deckhouse has more space for a workshop than Walker ever had for torpedoes, everyday repairs, and aviation maintenance as well.
He waved his hand back and forth.
She's got 6 depth charge launchers down her sides to frighten mountain fish,
his expression turned hard,
or kill subs, which she'll find as easy as Walker ever did, now we've matched the old girl's sound equipment.
He shrugged.
And her electrics are better than anything we've done. Commander Riggs has been bloody busy with all his contrivances. The only thing she hasn't got I wish she did is radar.
What's that?
The Holy Grail, Ambassador,
Alan answered wistfully.
Maybe someday.
Well then, Forrester said, I'm sure it must be amazingly technical.
He nodded at the cruiser and the 2 other ships.
Have you decided where these will go? I hope you'll consider sending them east. I know the 2 destroyers can't be completed quickly enough, but the cruiser might be just the thing to tip the scale against the blasted Doms. General Shinya is going all out to chase that loathsome Don Hernan to ground before he can escape, and the Governor Empress wants a push toward the Pass of Fire in support of that, perhaps even to break through at long last and join young Lieutenant Reynolds and Ensign Fask and the friends they've made.
He frowned.
I can't say I'm not disappointed to learn that the new United States were not as well prepared to support us as we'd been led to believe, but we've had steadfast assurances they'll now do their best.
Believe me, Bolton, Alan said, with feeling. I'd love to focus on kicking Don Hernan's sick ass. And you're right, this might be our best chance to get it done. But the situation's dicey in the West. We got our ass handed to us at the Battle of Mahé. Besides Bogpon Bay and Garon Eros, we lost a lot of auxiliaries. We have to get supplies, troops, and as many warships as we can scrape together out there as fast as we can. He regarded Forrester with a worried frown of his own. The fact of the matter is, despite everything, this may be our only chance to break the Grik as well, before they drown us in their own blood if they have to. Colonel Enoch says the truce with General Halleck is holding. He's busy tearing across Persia, killing other Grik.
Enoch and Svek's cavalry aren't actually fighting alongside him, but they're acting as his eyes.
How very strange, Forrester mused. Our forces, and at least a band of Grik, apparently getting along.
Yeah, bloody weird, Stokes agreed. And we're still not sure Halleck won't link up with General Esk, he cautioned. But even Colonel Svek, who hates Grik more than most, by the way, considers that unlikely. Esk could probably want Halleck's head after what he's done, and become.
Alan was nodding. But Esk is up to something. He's got well-trained and well-equipped Grik troops ashore in southern Madagascar. They were obviously staging to launch an overland assault against Grik City, probably coordinated with another amphibious attack. They're on a string now, supply-wise, since Chief Silva and Colonel Chak messed up their scheme, and we'll cut the string completely when we get Araka's battle group and Sandy Cat down there. But I have to stress, these were real troops, well-armed and disciplined. That's confirmed. Matt, Captain Reddy, always suspected the last attack was their way of getting rid of thousands of old-style Grik berserkers, while hurting us at the same time. We think they've got 10,000 or 20,000 new-style Grik already ashore, and all the rest of Esk's forces are just as well-trained and equipped.
And I don't like those rows of boat sheds Lieutenant Commander Leadham saw when he flew past the Grik capital of Sofesk, Stokes supplied. He and Jumbo Fisher took 2 clippers down and bombed him yesterday, along with a few dozen Grik Zeps, I'm happy to say. Dodged a lot of anti-air rockets, too, and took damage to one of the planes. But they reported the sheds were empty.
He shook his head.
Whatever was in them is gone. Scattered up the rivers, most likely. But I think Esk is getting ready for a big push of his own, and we need to jump before he does.
Alan nodded. Reports from Major Bakia Sabat and the Republic of Real People indicate Kaiser Nick Tak and General Kim finally have their forces on track to advance on Sofesk from the south. Bakia still has reservations about their preparedness, but everyone feels the urgency that we have to hit Esk before he hits us. He took off his hat and rubbed his brow.
I sense it too. Based on everything we know or can guess, if Esk gets all his shit in the sock at the same time, he'll have 750,000 troops to throw at us.
Generals Alden, Safir Moran, and Moln Rolak all agree we have to hit him first, before he consolidates, defeat his army in detail while it's still scattered. A surprise attack from the south should help with that, followed quickly by Alden's attack up the Zambezi with 3 full corps.
It's all we can do,
Alan added with a trace of desperation in his voice.
And I don't need to tell you what'll happen if we fail, he stated simply.
It does seem a rather risky scheme, Forrester observed somberly. But I don't know what else you can do. When do you plan to go?
At the last possible moment, Alan answered fervently. We'll keep up the harassing raids on Sofesk, increasing them as Araka and hopefully Madras get in place and add their planes to the effort. But the main point of those will be watching for when Esk makes his move. Maybe he won't gather his forces as long as we keep that up. We need time more than anything. Time to get more ships and planes and people down there. And time for Captain Reddy to deal with Kurokawa and Zanzibar.
I was wondering when you'd get to that, Forrester said,
glancing at the cruiser.
His possession of the battleship Savoie makes all this rather more problematic than would otherwise be the case.
You can say that again. Savoie and whatever else he has. At least one carrier with planes as good as ours. If he goes down to join with Esk and we can't stop him, he can shred Araka and Sandy Cat, and there won't be much we can do about it.
So you, and Captain Reddy in particular, will deal with him before he can cause more mischief,
Forrester predicted.
That's the plan. If Walker can be repaired in time, and if we can get our strike team assembled.
Alan smiled mirthlessly. With their 4 puny tanks. The tanks had been Alan's brainchild, and there'd be no more in time. The Assembly of Representatives had decided to focus resources not already allocated to more shipbuilding, and Alan could understand that. But what happened when they weren't fighting on the sea anymore?
And that's also your chief concern, is it not? Forrester asked gently. You're concerned that with Captain Reddy's wife, Lady Sandra, in his hands, Kurokawa will attempt to use her in some way that will prevent Captain Reddy from doing what he must? Alan sadly shook his head. No, Bolton. I'm sure he'll do exactly that. And I'm just as sure that nothing will keep Captain Reddy from his duty. I'm just worried what that'll do to him, to all of us. Forrester coughed, then turned to face the cruiser.
Indeed. Well, perhaps this will help.
Stokes snorted, and Forrester looked at him in surprise.
We'll do our damnedest to get her there, Stokes said, but it ain't bloody likely. She's still a few weeks from her trials. As she sits, she might not even make it there. She's the most experimental thing we've ever done.
Yeah, Alan agreed, his voice grim. And that's with shifts going around the clock to finish her. He shook his head.
All for nothing.
What on earth do you mean?
Forrester asked, troubled by Alan's tone.
He means she's no match for Savoie, Stokes replied. When we laid her down, we thought the worst she'd ever face was a Grik dreadnought or two, or a flock of dumb ships of the line. She'd serve them up proper without breaking a sweat from farther than they could even hit her. But we never dreamed there was anybody out there like the League. With something like Savoie, they could afford to just give away. What the hell else have they got? I'm the sticky beak around here now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.